Hi guys, Brian from Brian Boas here. Well, it's that time of year again, and with the shortening days and cooler weather comes the start of the boa breeding season. With my 2021 boa breeding pairings just around the corner, I have initiated the first step, which of course is cycling. And cycling is the set of environmental conditions to get boas ready to breed. Today I want to go over my general cycling procedures with you, as well as discuss some considerations that you should make when cycling boas to prepare them for breeding. If you're new to the channel, this is the place for information about all aspects of keeping and breeding boa constrictors in captivity. So if you like what you see, be sure to hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out on any of my future boa videos. When cycling boas to prepare them for breeding, there's really three main environmental conditions you need to worry about. And these are the temperature, the food, and the lighting. Typically, I'll have a drop of about 15 degrees Fahrenheit just at night. And this is during a period where the boas don't receive any food. Everybody does cycling a little bit differently, and there's really no one size fits all. I think people have this misconception that all there is to breeding boas is to get the exact conditions down right, the exact temperature that you keep the animals at, the exact amounts of time, the exact time to introduce them, and suddenly you're going to have a huge amount of success breeding them. The truth is, boas are not little legless robots, and they all behave differently. Sometimes it's really unpredictable. There are some boas that would breed under pretty much any type of cycling conditions, and there are other boas that probably wouldn't breed under whatever conditions you provide. So what I'm going to discuss in this video is basically just a general starting point for you, and I advise you to tweak your conditions and come up with what works best for you. So what I've been doing is a result of many years of experience, and typically I slightly tweak my cycling conditions every year. I feed my boas their last meal for the year in late November, around Thanksgiving, and then I give them a couple weeks to digest, and then I start the temperature cycling. And so for me, I drop the temperature a total of about 15 degrees Fahrenheit, and I only do this at night. So basically, before I start cycling, my enclosures have a hot spot of about 90 degrees on one side, and then the cool side is about 75 to 80 degrees. And so I basically drop down so the entire enclosure is about 75 degrees. And I do this over the course of about a month or so. And the way it works is I drop about 2 to 3 degrees once or twice a week. And then, so I go from the hot spot of 90 to a hot spot of about 88 to a hot spot of about 85, etc. I only drop the temperatures at night from 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. And during the day, I have the normal temperatures with the hot spot of about 90 degrees and the cool side of about 75 to 80 degrees. And just maintaining that hot spot of about 90 degrees, my cool side will automatically be about 75 to 80 degrees, with the ambient temperature of my snake room typically 70 to 75 degrees. If my ambient temperature in my snake room is going to go below 70, I use a little space heater just to bring the temperature up. But because I've got a lot of these heating devices in my snake room, it actually warms it up quite a bit warmer than the rest of the house, so I don't usually need to worry about providing the supplemental heating. With a temperature drop of 2 or 3 degrees Fahrenheit once or twice a week, I will reach the low temperature of 75 degrees or so by around late December. So typically, once I reach that low temperature, which happens usually between Christmas and New Year's, that's when I first pair up my boas. And I put the boas together at that low temperature, and then I maintain this temperature cycling for about 3 weeks or so, as you know, as the boas are together, hopefully breeding. And then I start to increase the temperatures back up to the normal range of a hot spot of 90 degrees. And I do this kind of in reverse, where I just increase the temperatures by 2 or 3 degrees Fahrenheit. Usually about every week or so I'll do this. So the ramp up is a little bit slower than the ramp down. But typically I'm back to my normal temperatures, where I have 24 hours a day, 90 degree hot spot, by around late February. And I'll keep the pears together during that entire time. So from late December, when they're paired up, through late February, they don't get any food. And so basically, if you go back to when I stopped feeding, which was in late November, most of my boas aren't fed for about 2.5 to 3 months. And so when late February comes, they've been together for 2 months and hopefully something's happened. But at that point, I'll usually separate them. I'll take the female out back to her cage. Usually I put the female in with the male. And then I feed them both a slightly smaller than normal meal, wait about a week, and then I pair them up again back together to hopefully, you know, mate some more. And then I keep them together for about 3 weeks to a month, separate them, feed them, a week later put back. And I repeat this process until the females are gravid or until about June. If they're not gravid by June, it's probably not gonna happen. But from late February back, you know, to June, they're at the normal temperature. So the temperature cycling only lasts from late November, or early December rather, out to late February. And importantly, they're only at that low temperature of 75 for about 3 weeks or so, from late December through around mid to late January. I know some other people keep the temperatures down a little bit longer, but I found this works quite well for me. I've also found I don't need to have the temperature drop during the day. It's fine to return the animals to their normal temperature during the day. And I found this is helpful because you're less likely to end up with animals getting respiratory infections or other issues from the cycling. And I should mention that before going into cycling, you want to make sure all of your animals are perfectly healthy. They don't have any signs of respiratory infections or any other illness. If they are, you don't want to cycle them or breed them. And if you do see an animal develop a sign of a respiratory infection, such as wheezing or, you know, runny nose, something like that, I would highly recommend to end the cycling and return them to the normal temperatures. I also want to mention it's really important that you know what your accurate temperatures are. So I would highly recommend getting one of these temperature guns, thermometers with a little laser. You can program your thermostat and it can say 85 degrees on the thermostat, but the actual temperature in your enclosure could be quite a bit different, anywhere from, you know, 75 up to 90 degrees, depending on a number of factors. So you really have to measure the actual temperature in your enclosure. And I would highly recommend that you monitor it quite a bit when you're doing the cycling, just to make sure that your animals are at the temperature that you think they should be. Before I forget, I just wanted to mention that this is one of my most anticipated pairings, or one half of one of them. This is a male Suriname that was born here in 2016 from the Prometheus bloodline. And I look forward to the possibility of a second generation breeding from this beautiful bloodline of Suriname boas. If you want to be able to learn from your breeding experience and tweak the conditions year to year, it's really critical you keep track of all your breeding records. And I do it kind of the old school way, just in this notebook. You can also, of course, use a computer if you want to do it that way. But every year, I write down all the conditions. So for 2020, this was my cycling conditions. I just wrote the dates and, you know, what the temperatures were, any other relevant notes. And then I have, for each pairing, I have a page where I write down the dates when I paired them up. I write down any behavior I see, whether I see evidence of copulation or any mating activity, or if they're not interested. I write down sheds in case the female is going to have her post-ovulation shed, etc. And I have a separate page for each of my pairings. And, you know, really valuable information. I've been doing this since I started breeding, so I built up quite a bit of valuable information that I look back on every year to try and tweak it to see what works best. And then the last page for 2020, we had the post-ovulation sheds and the predicted birth date of the litter. I'd basically just add 105 days to the post-ovulation sheds with the actual birth date. So it's really a gold mine of information that you can get when you're breeding year after year. And you definitely want to make sure you keep track of all this information so that you can learn from it. This female Pacalpa Peruvian redtail is half of another highly anticipated pairing that I have for 2021. So hoping for some of these beautiful golden redtails sometime in the late summer or fall of next year. So I wanted to mention one other aspect of cycling, and that is the lighting conditions. And some people manipulate the lighting conditions. I don't really worry about the lighting conditions so much. My boas receive lighting from ambient light that comes in through the windows. So there is some reduction of lighting as the days get shorter towards the fall and winter. But I don't really worry about, you know, precisely controlling lighting. You know, some people do this, you can do it if you want. But in my experience, it hasn't been necessary to result in successful breeding. The other thing I wanted to mention is that I do the cycling not just for animals that are going into breeding trials, but for any of my subadult boas that are at least a year or so old. I don't cycle boas that were born that year. So for example, I'm not gonna cycle my babies that were born in 2020, but this year I'll cycle animals that were born in 2019 or older. And for the subadults that are between about a year and a half to 3.5 years old, I don't do the full cycling. Basically, I reduce the temperature, but then I bring it right back up. So they're back to the normal temperatures in around mid-January, and they're only not fed for about a month and a half. So I don't do the full 3-month fast as I do with my adult breeders. They only get fasted for about a month and a half or so. And that seems to be working quite well for me. I want to briefly discuss the mechanics of cycling. That is, how do you go about achieving these temperatures? And if you have a good thermostat like the Herpstat, it's super easy because they have a nighttime drop feature. So basically, you just program the thermostat that it's going to go during the day at 90 degrees or whatever the temperature is. And then when you reach 8 o'clock at night, you program it to drop down to 87 degrees and to maintain that temperature until 6 a.m., at which point it goes back up to the 90 degrees. And in this way, I drop the nighttime temperature by 2 or 3 degrees once or twice a week until I reach the low of about 75 degrees in late December. And then I can just keep it that way for about 3 weeks before ramping back up to 90 degrees in the reverse fashion. So if you don't have a Herpstat, there are other ways you can do this. And a lot of people use these simple jump start devices to control their temperatures. And although these aren't as highly recommended as a Herpstat, they can work okay. And this is actually when I started breeding, I was using one of these. And the way that you can get your nighttime drop is you program it to 90 degrees to maintain the temperature during the day. And then you just plug it into one of these timers and you time it so that it's gonna have the nighttime where it switches off, and the timer will switch off the thermostat and switch off the heating for the amount of time you set. And again, I recommend about 8 hours at night that you drop the temperatures, and then in the morning it's going to switch it back on again and you're going to go back to your normal temps. If you do this, of course, you need to make sure that the background temperature in the room is the desired nighttime temperature, because the cage is going to have no heating when the thermostat is switched off. You could even go in at night and manually turn down the temperature. And my first year of breeding, that's actually what I did. I went in every night, I turned down the temperature by the amount of degrees, and that way I could maintain the heat on in the enclosure at a reduced setting, and then I would turn it back up during the day. And this will work, but it's not really recommended because you have to be super careful that you go in at the same time every day, turn it down, and then turn it back up again. And you know, most people don't have the energy to keep track of this. As I mentioned before, it's imperative you have one of these laser temperature thermometers so you can closely monitor the temperature in the cage. You can't rely on the temperature that you set on the thermostat because the actual temperature is often considerably different. Here we have one more animal that I'm going to be pairing up in a few weeks, and this is my Pearl Island boa. And this male bred successfully 2 years ago with the same female that he's going to be paired up with this year, or for 2021. So hopefully we'll have some more of these beautiful golden Pearl Island boas sometime in the summer of 2021. The last thing I wanted to mention is that not all boa breeders cycle, and some breeders have reported success with no cycling at all. They just keep the conditions the same year round. And this seems to be especially successful with some of the morph breeders. And as boas become more and more accustomed to captivity, its cycling will probably be less and less important. They're basically adapting to the conditions in captivity, and animals that can reproduce successfully under these conditions are going to be selected for, and thus the population is going to change genetically, i.e. it's going to evolve. So there's already evidence that many of these morph boas have changed quite a bit since they've been in captivity, and as boa breeding moves into the future, it's likely that cycling will become less and less important for these types of boas. Not sure if that's the case with some of the locality boas, but we'll just have to see. With locality boas, there's definitely a seasonality to their breeding, and typically locality boas are born in the summer or in the early fall, with the true red-tailed boas typically being born latest, often, you know, September, even October. With morph boas, these are typically born in the spring and summer, but litters of morph boas are basically being born at any time of the year. It's kind of amazing. I've been watching and seeing people that have boas being born in November, December. These aren't times you would expect boas to be born, but with boas adapting to the conditions in captivity, the breeding season is becoming less and less important, and there might be a day when you can just breed boas whenever you want, basically, with no cycling at all. We'll just have to see what happens. So I'd like to hear from you guys. I'm sure that you guys have your own opinions about cycling and your own experiences. So I'd really appreciate if you would share in the comments section what your cycling regimen has been and what's worked for you and how you change your cycling regimen over the years. I hope this video was helpful. As always, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to shoot me a line. Thanks for watching and enjoy your boas.